and say, there's a war going on.
There's a war going on.
Turn to your neighbor and tell them, there's a war.
There's a war.
Of wills.
Of wills.
Ooh. There's a war of your will. Does everybody get it?
Amen.
There's a war of wills going on right now. There's either a will of God or the will of man, which is the will of the devil. There's a war going on. Every day, every moment, every decision, there's a war going on. We're in a war. Amen? Amen. Turn to 1 Samuel chapter 15. Now your will is your choice. Many people's wills are in captivity. They don't even know it. When they're in captivity, you're doing the will of the devil. 1 Samuel 15. War of wills. It's kind of like the war of your choices. Because will is always associated with your choice. You have a free will. What you choose. Amen?
Amen?
What you choose. That's in other words, what you choose is what you sow. But what you sow is what you reap. So we got nobody to blame but ourselves. First Samuel 15 and verse 12. Would you speak it with me? Now Samuel was the king of Israel. Saul was the king of Israel. Samuel was the prophet. I'm sorry. Is everybody with me?
Amen.
Okay. And when Samuel, verse 12, rose early in the morning to meet Saul, who was the king, it was told Samuel, saying, from God, Saul went to Carmel, and indeed he set up a monument for himself. Little prideful thing. And he has gone on around, passed by, and gone down to Gilgal. Then Samuel went to Saul, and Saul said to him, blessed are you of the Lord. I have reformed the commandment of the Lord. It sounds like he's coming to say, hi, I'm your humble servant. When he's building statues of himself. Hello. But Samuel said, what then is this bleating of the sheep in my ears and the lowing of the oxen which I hear? And Saul said, they have brought them from the Amalekites. From the people spared the best of the sheep and the oxen to sacrifice to the Lord your God. He didn't say my God, did he? And the rest we have utterly destroyed. But you got to remember something. God told them to go there and kill everyone, all animal, all children, everything. Why? Because they were Nephilim. Does everybody get it? They were the seed of the serpent. He told them to kill everyone because he didn't want their existence to continue. And Saul did not obey him. Is everybody all right? Amen. Hallelujah. And verse 16, and Samuel said to Saul, be quiet. I will tell you what the Lord said to me last night. And he said to him, speak on. So Samuel said, when you were little in your own eyes, meaning you were humble, were you not the head of the tribes of Israel? And did not the Lord anoint you king over Israel? Now the Lord sent you on a mission. Everyone say, I'm on a mission. Come on, everybody. I am on a mission. God sent you on a mission. That's why you're here on the earth, right? And said, go and utterly destroy the sinners, the Amalekites, and fight against them until they are what? Consumed. Remember, this was the serpent seed line. Why then did you not obey the voice of the Lord? Why did you swoop down on the spoil and do evil in the sight of the Lord? And Saul said to Samuel, but I have obeyed the voice of the Lord and gone on the mission on which the Lord sent me. Did he obey the voice of God? No. And brought back Agag, king of Amalek. So he brings back the king. He brings back the spoil. He brings back stuff. I have utterly destroyed the Amalekites, but the people took of the plundered sheep and oxen the best of the things which should have been utterly destroyed to sacrifice to the Lord your God in Gilgal. Now, he just said, this is powerful. He said, but we have taken the best
that we were supposed to utterly destroy. So he already knew what the will of God was, wasn't he? But he chose to disobey it. So Samuel, the prophet, said to him in verse 22, "The Lord has great delight in burnt offerings and sacrifices, as in obeying the voice of the Lord. Behold, to obey is better than sacrifice, and heed than the fat of rams. For rebellion is a sin of witchcraft, and stubbornness is an iniquity and idolatry. And because you have rejected the word of the Lord, he also has rejected you from what? Being king." That's someone with authority. See, this is what's happening right now. There is much where there's a war over wills, where people are not doing the will of God, they're doing the will of themselves. And God is removing their authority. Because if you can't submit to God, you have no authority from God. Has everybody got it? See, so submission is vital. You submit to authority, you have authority. You don't submit to authority, the enemy knows that you're not backed by God, and he's going to eat you up and tear you up, and he's going to come to steal, kill, and destroy everything that you're associated with. In verse 24, "Then Saul said to Samuel, 'I have sinned, for I have transgressed the commandment of the Lord and your words, because I what? Feared the people and obeyed their voice.'" In other words, he obeyed the will of man instead of the will of God, didn't he? I'm telling you, this is a big problem right now. Tremendous. There is a war over the will.
And people
are losing their positions spiritually. They're fighting to maintain their own blessings instead of allowing God to bless them. See, when you work to get your blessing, you work for it. You have to maintain it. When God blesses you, he maintains it. That's all you got to do is maintain position. Verse 25. "Now, therefore, please pardon my sin and return with me that I may worship the Lord. But Samuel said to Saul, 'I will not return with you, for you have rejected the word of the Lord, and the Lord has rejected you from being king over Israel.' And Samuel turned around to go away. Saul seized the edge of his robe, and it tore. And Samuel said to him, 'The Lord has torn the kingdom of Israel from you today and has given it to a neighbor of yours who is better than you.'" Now, I want you to grab hold of something. When he said the Lord has torn the kingdom, I want you to grab hold of this completely, because what the Lord is saying, those individuals that are becoming rebellious, they will lose the kingdom of God. In other words, I will take away the kingdom of God and you will not enter. Why? Because you're not willing to obey me. You are still doing your will and not mine. Does everybody get this? This is where that lie of once always saved, you know, stuff. That's not the truth. He said rebellion is a sin of witchcraft. In other words, there's influence. There's influence. It's demonic influence. It's causing people to make wrong choices. That's the fight over wills. Is everybody with me? James 4. James chapter 4. The war of wills. God will never force your will, but he sure will try to influence it. He'll try to influence it. He influences by conviction. He influences it by the things that you see going around you. Amen? Yeah. Remember, the devil comes to steal, kill, and destroy, right? In James 4, verse 1, think about where you used to be in the kingdom and where you are now. Is the enemy stealing? If he's stealing, you've got open doors. Remember, the more things you choose to do the will of God, the more process you have in the kingdom. The less, the more that you're serving the kingdom of darkness. Remember, when you make a choice, you're sowing. You're either sowing into the kingdom of God or sowing into the kingdom of darkness, one or the other. James 4, verse 1, let's speak it. Where do what? Wars and fights come from among you. Do they not come from your desires for pleasure that war in your members? You lust and do not have. You murder and covet and cannot obtain. You fight in war, yet you do not have because you do not ask. You ask and do not receive because you ask amiss that you may spend it on your pleasure. In other words, you're asking it for to fulfill your lustful will, not the will of God. Let me tell you, when you're asking for something to fulfill the will of God, things change. Of course, you're changing. But if you're not, if your heart is not set towards God, then you're not looking to please God anyways. And you're lost. You're not looking to do the will of God. You're not looking to fulfill the kingdom of God. You're not looking towards eternity. You're caught up in the moment, in the now. Not looking at what the end result is. Not realizing that every choice and every decision you make has a ripple effect. Hallelujah. What does he say now? Adulterers and adulteresses, do you not know that friendship with the world is enmity with God? Whoever therefore wants to be a friend of the world makes himself an enemy of God. Who's the ruler of the earth? Satan. So when you become a friend of the world, you're under his authority. Or do you think that the scripture says in vain, the spirit who dwells in us yearns jealously? But he gives more grace, therefore he says, God resists the proud. Listen, pride is also associated with the will of man or the will of the enemy. But he gives grace, which is God's plan, to the what? Humble, which is associated with the will of God. You cannot do the will of God by being prideful. You can only do the will of God by being humble. Therefore, submit to God. Resist the devil and he'll flee from you. Draw near to God and he will draw near to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. Lament and mourn and weep. Let your laughter be turned into mourning and your joy to gloom. Humble yourselves under the mighty hand of the Lord, and then he will lift you up to do his will. Wow. So we see here there's that fight. It is called the war of wills. The will of man or the will of God, one or the other. Every decision you make is one or the other. You're either sowing to the kingdom of darkness or you're sowing into the kingdom of light. In 1 John chapter 2. In verse 15, came to hear the truth, right? Let's speak at verse 15. Do not what? Do not what? Do not love the world or the things in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. Hello? See, that the love of the Father's not in him. It doesn't mean the Father doesn't stop loving you. It means that you've rejected his love, and now you have the love. The love of the world, the lust of the eye, the lust of the flesh, and pride of life, is now supersede and taken over, rejected the Father of love, and accepted the Father of hell. Verse 16. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life is not of the Father, but is of the world. And the world is passing away and the lust of it. But he who does the will of God abides forever. In other words, those who are part of the world because it's passing away are going to pass away also. Verse 18. But only those who do the will of God abides forever. Abides forever. Now, there's an age of accountability. That age of accountability, some children are more age of accountability younger than others because they brought up in kingdom living. So their age of accountability might be 13 or 14, or others might be 16 or 17. But those that have known the truth because they've accepted it and executed and used it, it's different. God judges each and individual one. Whether they rejected it or accepted it, one or the other. And believe me, there is hell. And there is heaven. In verse 18, what does he say? Little children, it is the last hour, and you have heard that the Antichrist is coming. Even now, many Antichrists have come, by which we know that it is the last hour. In other words, these are the voices of strangers. They went out from us, but they were not of us. Hello. Why? Because the influence of demonic influence has caused an individual to exchange the will of God for the will of man, or never even reach the will of God. It says they went out from us, but they were not of us. For if they had been with us, they would have what? Continued with us, but they went out that they might be made manifest that none of them were of us. Listen, how many of y'all know God knows what we do behind closed doors? Nobody gets away with it. Nobody. Oh, but well, I'm a good person. Forget that stuff. It ain't about being good anymore. See, there's something that needs to be maintained. It's called discipline. Discipline. We must be disciplined, which makes you and I consistent. If we're not disciplined and consistent, it's impossible to overcome your enemies. I'm going to say it again. If you are not disciplined and consistent, it is impossible to overcome your enemies. It's impossible. You will never overcome your enemy. You may think you're going to. You may hope you can, but you will not. Verse 20, it says, you have an anointing from the Holy One, and you know all these things. In other words, the anointing, the eternal presence, power, and truth of God Almighty, carried by the Holy Spirit, is convicting. He's saying, man, stop. You know this. You know better. But I'm telling you, he'll only come so many times, so he backs away and says, let it run. Let it run. And hopefully you'll call out to me on your last breath. Everything that you and I are doing right now is affecting your eternal position. That's why the word says, laying up treasures in heaven. Everything you and I do right now is affecting our eternal position. And nobody lives in this realm forever. Everyone must enter the other place. So it's time to start keeping your mind eternally bound, not temporary bound. We got to ask ourselves, what am I doing for the kingdom? Am I doing more for the kingdom than myself? What am I doing? Am I doing the things that are pleasing God or displeasing God? Am I actually doing his will or my will? And then you know where you stand. Don't ignore this self-examination. We must examine ourselves in every decision, in every day. Amen? Hallelujah. He says, I've not written you because you don't know the truth, but because you know it and that no lie is of the truth. Again, the will of God, those who do the will of God abides forever. There is that war. It is constant, every decision. We must first reject the worldly influence of the presence of evil, so we can do the will of God. But again, we must put into place, if you know the truth, you must practice the truth. You must use the truth. If you're not willing to use the truth, you can't do the will of God. See, many people know the truth, but choose not to put it into practice. Amen? The word says, if you know the truth, you'll be free. He doesn't mean that if you know the truth and not put it into practice, because the word says that you and I must be a doer of the will of God. So we must be doers of the truth to overcome. If you're not a doer of the truth, you will not overcome. It's impossible. Is everybody okay? See, so many times people are more concerned about what is necessary instead of divine order. See, when you are doing things according to the will of God, it's always associated with the divine order. Worldly influence or the presence of evil. The only way to discern the difference is by practicing the truth. When you practice the truth, the will of God unfolds. Does everybody understand this? When you practice the truth, the will of God unfolds. As the will of God begins to unfold, you begin to step into your destiny. So it's impossible to step into your destiny until you practice the truth, because only by practicing the truth will the will of God unfold. Amen? Again, this is not Club Jesus. We are enlisted or drafted into the army of God. So many people take this as a club. It's Club Jesus. Yeah, I'm saved. I can do whatever I want, baby. Yeah, I can go out and fornicate when I want, lie when I want, cheat when I want, steal when I want. Yeah, no problem. This is Club Jesus. I'm okay. I just need to repent and, you know, continue on. Don't work that way. Rude awakenings are about to happen to many people. Matthew 6. So discipline is the key to consistency, isn't it? Discipline leads into a relationship, which leads into a love affair. When you have that love affair, discipline isn't a problem. You want to do it. You want to do it. You want to depart. You want to do the things that are pleasing to God. You live to do that. Why? Because you've entered a new life. If you don't want to do it, you've not entered a new life. And you're lost, living outside of salvation's truth. Verse 31. Let's speak it. Therefore do not what? Worry, saying, what shall we eat? What shall we drink? And what shall we wear? For after all these things, the Gentiles seek. For your heavenly Father knows that you need all these things. How many know God knows what you need? Amen. But he asks you to do something. He says, but seek first the kingdom of God and his what? Righteousness. His righteousness is his character. His character will always produce the will of God. And all these things will be what? Added to you. So you don't need to go beg for things. Just go seek the kingdom of God, his righteousness. And as his character becomes manifested in you, his will begin to unfold. Why? Because you're practicing the truth. Verse 34, therefore do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about its own things. Sufficient for the day is its own troubles. Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. His character will produce his will. You know, so many people think that there's so many things that are necessary. God knows what's necessary. Amen? But there are things that are necessary. He provides all because he's the source. He sets things in order. It is a must for his will to unfold as things get set in order. It's called divine order for divine will to be released. As things become in a divine order arena, because he sets things in order, his will begins to unfold, and again, we begin to step into destiny. We begin to what? Step into what? Our destiny. Destiny is also associated with God's time. God's time is actually God's timing of his will. It's called destiny. Destiny. There's a fulfillment that he wants me and you to do. What we need to do, though, first is fold up ourselves, throw it in the garbage. That's how his will unfolds. When you fold up, he unfolds. Romans 12. You know, what did Jesus say? Thy will be done on earth, what? As in heaven. Again, this isn't Club Jesus. This is a military operation. You and I have been rescued to fulfill a mission, and not ours, his. Romans 12, verse 1, I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy. Everyone say holy. Holy, 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 holy means anointed. Holy means without blemish. Holy means without sin. Holy. Acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service or your responsibility. And do not be conformed to this world. Why? Because if you stay conformed to this world, you're going to die. But be what? Transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good, acceptable, and perfect will of God. In other words, the renewing of your mind is by having the truth, practicing the truth, bringing it to remembrance. And as we continue to practice the truth, The will of God begins to unfold, and we begin to step into our destiny. 2 Timothy 2. Many people are turning from transformation to back to conformity to the world. In verse 20, let's speak it. But in a great house there are not only vessels of gold and silver, but also of wood and clay, and some for honor and some for dishonor. Do you want to be a vessel of honor or dishonor? God knows. Therefore, if anyone what? Cleanses himself from the worldly sins and lusts of the eye, lusts of the flesh, and pride of life. Cleanses himself from the latter. Departs from evil. He will be a vessel of honor. Sanctified and useful for the master, prepared for every good work. See, some people are not willing to do the will of God. They want to be Christians, but they want to do their own will. It will never work. Never. Flee also youthful lust, but pursue righteousness. Pursue what? Now, wait a minute. He just says, flee youthful lust. Lust of the eye, lust of the flesh, and pride of life. Fornication, adultery, lying, sin. But pursue righteousness, which is the truth, right standing with God. Faith, love, and peace with those who call out on the Lord out of a what? Pure heart. Man, don't be hanging with people that don't have a pure heart. You're going to hell. It only takes one hit of a dope, one step in front of a car. It only takes one false step that you can die, and the next thing you know, you wake up in another location. Verse 23. But avoid foolish and ignorant disputes, knowing they are, what? Generate strife. And a servant of the Lord must not quarrel, but be gentle to all, able to teach, and patient in humility, correcting those who are in opposition, if God will perhaps grant them repentance, so that they may what? Know the truth, practice the truth, and that they may come to their senses and escape the snare of the devil, having what? Been captive. They are taken captive to do what? His will. So doing the will of the devil. So you're either doing the will of the devil or you're doing the will of God, one or the other. There is no in-between. None. There's no gray area. It's either light or darkness. None other. We've got to become more serious in this arena. We got to start discerning, who am I serving? Are you, self-examination. Who am I really serving? Hosea 5. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. War of wills. In verse 10, let's speak it, please. The princes of Judah are like those who remove the landmark. That means they are removing restraints. Restraints of what? Restraints over the flesh. I will pour out my wrath on them like water. Ephraim is oppressed and broken in judgment. Because why? Because he's willingly... Because he willingly walked by the what? Human precepts. That's what? To do the will of man. Human precepts. Human understanding. He said, Ephraim is oppressed and broken in judgment because he willingly walked by human precept. Therefore, I will be to Ephraim like a moth and to the house of Judah like rottenness. In other words, what did they do? They removed the restraints of the flesh to do the will of man, or what we call the will of the devil. That war will is still continuing. You and I are in that constant battle. You and I are constantly being influenced to do the will of the enemy. We are hard-pressed every day. While you sleep, when you're awake, remember the ruler of this earth is Satan. He sends his demonic forces to you. No matter where you look, no matter where you go, there is that influence to try to change the will of God to the will of the devil. Remember when the Lord rebuked Peter. Amen. What did he say? Get behind me, Satan. You are not concerned for the will of man, but for the will. I mean, you're not concerned for the will of God, but for the will of man. In 1 Thessalonians 4. God will meet your need far above all you could ever ask or think when it's his time. See, people get so caught up in the world that they lose sight to even ask themselves, am I doing God's will or my will? But if you're a person of prayer every morning and you make connection every morning, that's always before you. It's always there because you're always surrendering your will for his will. It's constant. But during the day, you got to understand that you may be influenced to change that will. So you got to be discerning. And verse 1, please, let's speak it. Finally then, brethren, we urge and exhort in the Lord Jesus that you should abound more and more, just as you receive from us, how you ought to walk and to what? Please God. For you know what commandments we gave you through the Lord Jesus. This is the will of God. Here he is. He's beginning to explain it. He's going to tell you the only way to do his will is to first do something. Your what? Sanctification. In other words, you must come out from among them. You must be separate. You must depart from evil. You must come out of a life of sin. You must be sanctified. That you should obtain from what? Sexual immorality. Why? He knows that lust is going to be the major problem. That each of you should know how to possess his own vessel in sanctification and what? Honor. Not in passion of lust like the Gentiles who do not know God. You know how many believers are calling themselves believers? But in the eyes of God, he's saying, they don't know me. They don't know me. They're still doing their will. They don't know me. Not in passion of lust, like the Gentiles who do not know God, that no one should take advantage and defraud his brother in this matter, because the Lord is the avenger of all such, as we also forewarned you and testified. For God did not call us to uncleanness, but in what? Holiness. Therefore, he who rejects this does not reject man, but God, who also has given us the Holy Spirit. This is powerful. He's saying, look at, you're not rejecting the Word. You're rejecting God. Amen? Sanctification is the first part. It's separation from evil influence of thoughts, emotions, desires that reject the will of God. If there's no separation or sanctification, there's no recognizing the trap of the enemy. You can never recognize it. That's why the Word tells us, abide, abide, abide. The less you abide, the further you drift. Romans 8. Romans 8. Hallelujah. The war of wills. Hallelujah. We need to send this message to the Democratic Party. That's why they're called the left. Doesn't anybody ever, I mean, I'm telling you. That's why they're called the left. They do the will of the devil. That's why the other ones are called the right. You're either right or wrong. Hallelujah. One does the will of God, one does the will of Satan. And boy, is there a war going on because of that. I'm telling you what. Fake news is nothing but lying. They love the lie. They're under the father of all lies. We're seeing a tremendous thing going on in our government right now, but I'm telling you, there's arrest coming big time. God is about to arrest many of them. because he's hearing the prayers of a saint. See, that's where you got to pray. You got to pray, Lord, expose them. Expose the pedophiles. Expose them. Expose those that are servants of the devil that's in our government. And put your servants in. And, of course, expose those who are of the devil in the body of Christ. Romans 8, 28. Let's speak it. We know that all things work together for good to those who what? Who love God. Now, wait a minute. He says, if you love me, you do what? Obey me. I love them, but I'm going to do my will. Well, then you don't love them. To those who are the called according to his purpose. So we know that all things work together for the good. Hallelujah. To those who love God and to those who are called according to his purpose. For whom he foreknew, he also what? Predestined to be conformed to the image of his son. In other words, his character. It's a character of righteousness. See, those, look at, Jesus ascended to heaven. When the character of Christ is formed in you, you get access to heaven. But the character of the devil will not allow you access to heaven. Don't work that way. So our predestined is to be conformed into the image and character of Christ with his righteousness. So that we hate evil, we love righteousness. We hate the works of the flesh and we love the works of the Spirit. There must be a hatred in that arena. You must hate evil. If you don't, then your heart is not right. If there's no hatred for evil, it doesn't mean you hate people. But see, you see beyond that, you know that there's influence of demonic activity, although you want to slap the hell out of that person and make room for heaven. Amen. And hopefully they come to their senses and escape the will of the devil and do the will of God. But, you know, the law doesn't prevent us. I mean, it prevents us. It doesn't help in that. We'd be all arrested, you know. Hallelujah. We'll let God take care of that part. We're just the intercede. Amen. Verse 30. Would you read it with me? Did we finish the rest? Oh, verse 29. For whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. Many of us are some of the firstborn of our families and cultures. Moreover, verse 30. Whom he predestined, these he also called. Everyone say, I've been called. Don't reject it. Don't reject that call. Torment, torment, and more torment. Moreover, whom he predestined, these he also called. Whom he called, these he also justified. Whom he justified, these he also glorified. Hallelujah. What then shall we say these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He did not spare his own son, but delivered him up for us. Oh, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Who shall bring a charge against God's elect? That means those who are right with God. It is God who justifies. Who is he who condemns? It is Christ who died and furthermore is also risen, who is even at the right hand of God, who also makes intercession for me and you. Who shall separate us from the love of God? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword, as it is written, for your sake we are killed all day long. We are counted as sheep for the slaughter. Yet in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death nor life nor angels nor principalities nor powers nor things present nor things to come, nor height nor death nor depth nor any other created thing shall be able to separate us from the love of God which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. In other words, there's nothing that you can do that can stop God from loving you. Nothing. But because he constantly loves you, doesn't mean that you won't be separated from him. His love will not prevent you from going to hell. Your will is what puts us in hell. Does everybody get it? Mark 8, So we are predestined to be conformed to his image and character. So he begins to unfold his will, allowing us to step into the destiny and the timing of his perfect will. So the timing of his perfect will is actually called destiny. Mark 8. Is everybody okay? Amen. Are you getting this? Amen. 34. Mark 8, 34. When Jesus had called the people, everyone say people. People. Are you a people? Praise God. Are you a people pleaser or a God pleaser? When he had called the people to himself, how many of you know God calls you to himself every day? Come on. Come on, let's talk. Later, I'm too busy. Okay. You cannot do his will until you make connection, but you first must disconnect from the world to connect with him. When he called the people to himself with his disciples also, he said to them, whoever desires to come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. For whoever desires to save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake and the gospel's sake will save it. For what will it profit a man if he gains the whole world and loses his soul? Or what will a man give in exchange for his soul? For whoever is ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of him the Son of Man will also be ashamed when he comes in the glory of his Father with his holy angels. So, in other words, deny your will, which means deny yourself. And then fight to follow. And Titus 1. He says, for there are what? Many insubordinate, both idle talkers and deceivers, especially those of the circumcisions, whose mouths must be stopped, who subvert whole households, teaching things which they ought not for the sake of dishonest gain. One of them, a prophet of their own, said, Cretans are always liars, evil beasts, lazy gluttons. This testimony is true. Therefore, rebuke them sharply, that they may be sound in faith, not giving heed to Jewish fables and commandments of men who turn from the truth. To the pure, all things are pure, but to those who are defiled, unbelieving, nothing is pure, but even their mind and conscience are defiled. They profess to know God, but in works or in will, they what? Deny him, being abominable, disobedient, and disqualified for every good work. Denying him in works means denying him in will. They choose or denying him in choice. They make a choice. These people are what we call defiled by the influence of evil, not knowing they have been taken captive. Listen, Satan's greatest weapon is deception, right? Some people don't even know they're being taken captive. Some people come to church and listen to the word every week and don't even know they're being taken captive. They're still being influenced. And the word says, always learning, but never able to come to the knowledge of the truth. Proverbs 3. Proverbs 3, please. That's what the word says. First thing he says, those who believe in my name, they will what? Cast out what? Demons. That means drive out demonic presence every day, wherever you go. First, you got to drive them out of you. Proverbs 3 and verse 1. Let's speak it. My son, do not forget my law, but let your heart keep my commands, for length of days and long life and peace they will add to you. In other words, his commands and his law is his will, isn't it? Let not mercy and truth forsake you. Bind them around your neck. Write them on the tablet of your heart. And so find favor and high esteem in the sight of God and man. Here we go. Trust in the Lord with all of your heart and lean not on your own understanding. Oh, in all of your ways acknowledge him, and he'll direct your paths to do his will. So many times people lean on their own understanding because they're still leaning on their own will. He says, stop it. Quit trying to figure it out and calculate it. Trust me and follow me. Just do what I'm asking. Read my word and do it. It's real simple. Depart from evil. Get sanctified. Quit allowing everything to dictate your decisions. Quit allowing finances. Quit allowing your jobs. Quit allowing everything, the music, movies, videos, associations, people. Quit allowing those to dictate your will. You have a free will. And allow God to take your will to manifest his. Because if his isn't being manifested, the enemy's is. It's one or the other. He says in verse 17, don't be wise in your own eyes, bonehead. Fear the Lord and depart from evil, right? Don't be wise in your own eyes. That's what he keeps saying. Stop leaning on your own understanding. Don't try and calculate it with your carnal wisdom. That just produces boneheads. Amen? So quit trying to calculate it all out. Just decree the truth, practice this truth. The will of God will unfold, and you'll begin to step in your destiny. I mean, is that simple? Yes. But it's going to take abiding in fellowship. Or the enemy will come and begin to start that drift. He does it very subtle. You know, many times many of us have fallen into the place where it's too late. We bit the bait for such a long time and drifted for so long. You know, every one of us is called to be in position in the kingdom of God. As an officer in a position. Many people have sold out their birthright and their position for wealth, for fame, for lust. They sold it out. Just like Esau. To fulfill their own desires. Do not be wise in your own eyes. Fear the Lord and depart from evil. In other words, let God build the house. It will be what? Health to your what? Your flesh. And strength to your bones. Honor the Lord with your possessions. Oh my goodness. Honor the Lord with your possessions. Many people are hoarders, Christian hoarders. It's all about me, 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 me. Honor the Lord with your possessions and with the first fruits of your increase. So your barns will be filled with plenty and your vats will overflow with new wine. My son, do not despise the chastening of the Lord, nor detest his correction. For whom the Lord loves, he corrects, just as the Father, the Son, in whom he delights. Oh, yes. Lean not on your own understanding. Stop trying to figure it out. You know, when you don't know what to do, you wait. You wait. The word says, wait. I waited patiently for the Lord. He's just trying to get you killed more to get you for the next position because you're going to have to do more. Deuteronomy 30. Deuteronomy 30. Deuteronomy. You know, when you begin to look around the world, you see the tremendous battle over the will. Tremendous. There are many people losing. There are many people winning. In verse 15, let's speak it together. See, I have set before you today life and good and death and evil. Hello? Life and good and death or evil? Which one do you want? In that I command you today to love the Lord your God, to walk in his ways and keep his commandments, his statutes, and his judgments, that you may live and multiply, and the Lord your God will bless you in the land which you go and possess. But if your heart turns away so that you do not hear and are drawn away and worship other gods and serve them, I announce to you today that you shall surely perish. You shall not prolong your days in the land which you cross over the Jordan to go into the promise and possess. I have called heaven and earth as witness today against you that I have set before you life and death, blessing and cursing. Therefore, choose life that both you and your descendants may live, that you may love the Lord your God, that you may obey his voice, and that you may cling to him, for he is your life and the length of your days, and that you may dwell in the land which the Lord swore to your fathers, to Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and to give them. How many of y'all know that's for us? Amen. And Luke chapter 8. Let's speak it now. The parable is this. The seed is the word of God. Those by the wayside are the ones who hear. Then the devil comes and takes away the word out of their hearts, lest they should believe and be saved. But the ones on the rock are those, when they hear, receive the word with joy. And these have no root. Everyone say, no root. No root. The only way you maintain root is to maintain by abiding. Other than that, the root dries up. Who believe for a while, and in time of temptation, they what? Fall away. Now the ones that fell among the thorns are those who, when they have heard, go out and are choked with cares, riches, and pleasures of life, and bring forth no maturity. But the ones that fell on good ground are those who, having and heard the word of with a noble, which means humble, and a good heart, keep it and bear fruit with patience. Wow. Again, this is powerful. Having no root. Does everybody see that? No root. That means no connection to the living water. That's an eternal life. In Psalm 1, he explains it. See, the enemy always wants to draw you out of God's presence because he knows that's the place you drink. That's why we have the river every Friday. That's why we worship. Why? Because we must drink. We want to keep that open root that comes and drinks. In verse 1, blessed is the man, hallelujah, who walks not in the counsel of the ungodly or the rebellious, who stands in the path of sinners, nor sits in the seat of the scornful. Why? Because that's going to influence his will. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, or in the truth. See, when you delight in the truth of God, you practice it. And as you practice the truth of God, his will unfolds. And it allows you to step in destiny. His delight is in the law, or the truth of the Lord. In his law, he meditates day and night. In other words, he's always comparing, he's self-examining with the truth. Am I doing what's pleasing you, Lord? See, if you don't even ask God, am I doing what's pleasing you, then you're disconnected. Because maintaining that connection is always an area. Am I pleasing you? Is this decision going to please you? We're always keeping the Lord before us. And in his law, he meditates day and night. Are you ready for this? Look at verse 3. He shall be like a what? A tree planted by the what? Rivers of water. That's life. That brings forth its fruit in its season, whose leaf all shall not wither, and whatever he does shall what? Prosper, because he's rooted not only in the truth, but in the living water. Rooted. He shall be a tree planted by the river. The river what? Life. That's why he says abide. Abide in my presence, abide in my word, abide in the fellowship. But the ungodly, the rebellious, are not so. They are like the chaff which the wind drives away. Therefore, the ungodly shall not stand in the judgment of the reward, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. For the Lord knows the way of the righteous, but the way of the ungodly shall what? Perish. Remember, ungodly means rebellious, and I'm going to close at Psalm 149. Psalm 149. We want to be rooted. See, people's roots have been dried up. Why? Because there's a war of the wills. Psalm 149, let's speak it together, please. Verse 1, what does it say? Praise the Lord. Sing to the Lord a new song and his praise in the assembly of the saints. Hello. Let true ministries rejoice in their maker. Let the children of Zion be joyful in their king. Let them praise his name with a what? Woohoo! Dance. Dance. Everybody dance now. Let them praise his name with a dance. Some of you need to dance and shake the monkey off your backs. Kick off those religious feet. And let them sing praises to him with a what? Timbrel and harp. For the Lord takes pleasure in his people. He will beautify the humble with salvation. See, it takes some humility to dance. Let the saints be joyful in glory in the glory realm. And let them sing aloud on their beds. Let the high praises of God be in their mouth and a two-edged sword in their hand. To what? See, you can't execute without being backed by the anointing. To execute vengeance on the nations and punishments on the demonic peoples. To bind the kings and principalities with chains and their nobles with fetters of iron. To execute on them the written judgment. This honor have what? The saints. Well, if you ain't in position, you ain't backed. This honor have all the saints who are in position. Praise the Lord. War of wills. Self-examine. Amen. You're either doing the will of the devil or the will of God. There's a tremendous war going on in influence. Amen. Praise God. Father, we thank you for your word. We are honored and blessed. Apply the blood of Jesus on the seed that's been imparted so the devil can't steal it. Keep us rooted, Lord, to the river of life, that we may drink of life, the river, and eat of your word and flesh in Jesus' name. Everybody said amen?